It's an honor to have you all here. And I want to start off because we have a number of elected officials joining us. I'm going to ask if you'd stand so we can thank you for your service and for joining us today. So will all of our elected officials please stand up? Many of us have been coming to the State of DIA event for the past 7 years, and we all know that DIA has transformed mobility for our region. They're delivering worldwide mobility. Denver International Airport is our state's single largest economic engine, so we can guarantee we will always partner closely with DIA to support its growth because it impacts the growth of our state. Beyond the mobility and access DIA supports for every business and access to the world outside of Colorado, they also have a master plan that is truly coming to life under the leadership of Kim Day. It maximizes the economic impact of DIA with an airport hotel, an A-line, the approval of a ballot measure last year that sets the stage for the Aerotropolis. Thank you, Kim, for everything you're doing to make that happen. It's that master plan and that kind of work is exactly why this event focuses on the comprehensive mobility picture. Planes, trains, and lanes. Yes, self-driving automobiles even. Our successes have truly been because we have some values that guide us. We're innovative, we're always thinking about our future, and we always work together as a region and across our sectors. Today's program will show and highlight how important those values continue to be as we try to shape the future of mobility for Colorado. It's more important than ever that our transportation systems, our mobility systems, provide choice and options to move both people and goods. Our business community reinforces our commitment to those values and our efforts to keep Colorado on the cutting edge by supporting today's event. So to all of our sponsors, a huge thank you. But in particular, we want to highlight today's presenting sponsor, Aero Electronics, our platinum sponsor, United Airlines, our gold sponsors, Denver International Airport, Lufthansa, Visit Denver, and WSP Parsons Brinckerhoff, our silver sponsors, AECOM, Dyna Electric Colorado, HNTB Colorado, Jacobs, Jeppesen, Log Plan, Mortenson Construction, and Southwest Airlines. To all of you, our deepest thanks for continuing to bring us together at the cutting edge of these kinds of issues of mobility. And to all of you, our table sponsors, thank you for joining us. You're listed in the program. If you want to make sure your name is there, or you want to see who your neighbors are, please check out everybody who's supported us today. You know, as we talk about the values of innovation and collaboration, I really want to highlight a new initiative at the Chamber that is very relevant to today's conversation. Our commitment to transportation, mobility, and technology has led us to create a new affiliate, a strategic partnership that we call Mobility Choice. This nonprofit brings together the private sector as well as three major public sector mobility agencies: our Regional Transportation District, our Denver Regional Council of Governments, and our Colorado Department of Transportation, to plan for our future and create a blueprint for mobility for all of Metro Denver. This effort will ensure we maximize the return on current infrastructure investments like fast tracks, as well as how we're going to be at the forefront of the transformational changes technology is bringing to mobility. By uniting the public and private sectors, we can better plan for our mobility needs of our future workforce. It's the first time in our history we have joined together as public and private sectors. And as best as we can tell, we're first in country to take this planning approach as well. Don Hunt, who we all know as both a former CDOT director and also a respected business leader, has taken on this initiative to start it up for us. Thanks to our partners who are joining us and to all of our companies who are joining the nonprofit so we can do this work. It's exciting to begin looking at what's next and how different our future will be. It's also exciting to have so many business leaders here today who are interested in continuing to engage and help create the future of mobility for Colorado. Thanks again for joining us and enjoy the program.
Please welcome today's pilot, our conductor, the backseat driver in your driverless car. From our presenting sponsor, Arrow Electronics, Aidan Mitchell, Vice President, IoT Global Solutions.
Good afternoon. It's a real pleasure for Arrow to be part of this event. We're proud to call Denver and Colorado our home. We're the largest company by revenue here in Colorado, and we're a Fortune 119 business. And our role is really to integrate technology and to make it seamless. And we're proud to be part of an ecosystem of companies that's really trying to make life easy, to live in more clean, safe, and where mobility is something that's convenient and not a hassle. And, you know, when we take a look at this effort, we're proud to work with the future of metro mobility, the Chamber, the Denver Metro EDC, and RTD, and the Colorado of Transportation, all who have great roles in figuring out the plan for this city as we move ahead. Before I introduce a great panel of speakers that we've lined up for you today, I want to give a little bit of context to why this effort is so important. Denver is one of the few cities that wasn't founded based on a railroad, based on a body of water, based on a confluence of traffic. It was founded out of opportunity, gold, to be precise. And if you take a look at the residents who came to this city and then invested to grow it into the city it is today, looking back, we may not have always been as confident as we are right now about the future and the growth of the city. And Denver is a really good model for what's happening all around the world. By 2030, it's forecasted that about 5 billion people, or 60% of the world's population, are going to live in urban environments. And that's going to continue to apply pressure in terms of the quality of life, the services, the security, and the mobility that we need to have in those cities. And our city has continued to really look back at key milestones. 1995 was a year when both Coors Field and the Rockies started to reinvigorate downtown. It was also the year that Denver International Airport opened. And to put it into perspective, look at how far we've come. I counted no fewer than 15 or so cranes in the Denver area this morning. And we're taking a look at an international airport that's now the fifth busiest in the country. And the next transformative wave that Kelly spoke about, the Mobility Choice Initiative, is really now our opportunity to collaborate and engage in that planning process for where the city is going to go next and how we're going to do that, both with insight and flexibility to make sure that we're adaptive and that we're inbounding in these technologies that are going to make it happen. And there is a sense of urgency. Colorado added over 100,000 people in 2015. Denver, in fact, the Denver, Aurora, and Greater Colorado Combined Statistical Area, that 12-city borough added to a population that's now 3.4 million people and growing, making us the 16th ranked most populous metropolis in the United States. And we've got a great brand. Colorado and Denver has got some really great claims. 2016, USA, by USA News and World Report, outlined Denver as the best place to live, and all of us here know that's the case. Colorado is the fourth fastest growing state in the United States, ranked in 2014. And we ranked number one for labor supply and number four for economic climate, according to Forbes. And Colorado is the nation's second most highly educated state for residents, with over 38% having a bachelor's degree. And we continue to see that all those are going to be the recipe to drive the growth and the population expansion of our city and state. So let me recognize our speakers today. We're going to have Kim Day, who's the CEO of Denver International Airport. Jim Doyle, president of Panasonic Enterprise Solutions. Dr. Philip Kamshoff, partner at McKinsey & Company. And the panel is going to talk about really how we have made the progress in Denver thus far by being collaborative, by being having a very inclusive planning process, and that the decisions we're making together is allowing us to deploy some of the technology and facets that we're seeing much faster than we might have estimated, but also on budget and on time. And we're not just a vital regional hub, being the largest city in about an 800-mile radius with a big hinterland. We're quickly becoming an international hub, thanks to the role that DIA and the city that has done. So before we transition to those speakers, I want to recognize that our mayor, Mayor Hancock, could not be with us today. And that's because he's on a very important mission. Right now, in DC, the mayor is pitching Denver's Smart City Challenge application. Denver is one of seven finalist cities in the US Department of Transportation Challenge. The winner has the opportunity to receive up to $40 million of investment, and obviously it's a very key effort for this city. We're pleased to have the mayor being so vibrant and evident in all of the work that the Future Mobility Project is underway, and he's taken the time to prepare a video and some remarks today. So let's pause for that. Thank you.
Hello everyone, Denver Mayor Michael Hancock here. I want to thank you for attending this very important and yet very timely conversation about the future of metro mobility. What a great opportunity for us, as we're one of the fastest growing regions in the entire United States of America, for us to have this conversation about our future. Indeed, it will take the airport, it will take all we're doing with RTD and the tremendous investments we're making, as well as automobiles and bicycles and people walking about our great metro region, for us to address this growing region and to do it successfully. It's all a part of who we are. It's all a part of our DNA and our future. We are here today because our pioneers made the commitments to invest in mobility, helping people get where they need to go in a very efficient and proactive manner. And so I'm proud that you're in this room today. In fact, I am in Washington, D.C. right now, pitching Denver and our metro region and our technology and innovation as one of the best regions in the nation to address growing metropolises and making sure that we address the issues of mobility. And so while I couldn't be there with you, know that I'm there in spirit, and today, together, we are working on addressing this issue of our metro mobility and how we will address it effectively going forward. So thank you for being here. I look forward to rolling up the sleeves and working with you as we continue to make our metro region not only the fastest growing, but one of the best and most desired places to live in the United States of America.
Let's now welcome our first presenter, Kim Day, CEO of Denver International Airport. I'm curious to hear about the hidden bunker under the airport. How about you?
all I can say is if I told you where the hidden bunker was, it wouldn't be hidden now, would it? So we're not going to talk about bunkers. Good afternoon. I'm delighted to be here today to talk about our favorite airport. You know, before we talk about where we're going, I thought it would be worth taking a minute and looking back on our beginning. And what you see on the screen up here is a side-by-side comparison, the difference between Denver's two airports, Stapleton and DIA. And it's striking. Economic impact has increased over 700% since 1994. Jobs have almost doubled. And today, there are only 6 homes within our noise mitigation contour, where there are approximately 13,000 at Stapleton. It's an understatement to say that our visionaries gave us an amazing facility. They gave us room to grow. They gave us a facility that was designed for major hub operations. But their crystal ball didn't get quite everything right. We've grown much faster than they projected. And they predicted that 65% of our traffic would be connecting. Those would be people staying on the concourses. And only 35% would begin and end their trip using the train to the terminal or using our parking, our rental cars, and Peña Boulevard. The truth is, the percentage is exactly reversed. So today, as we grow fast, we're feeling the pressure on all those landside facilities. They also couldn't possibly predict some of the changes that have happened in the last 20 years, like this, technology, like the ever-increasing passenger expectations that you bring to our facility, and of course, the impact of 9/11. You know, let's talk about those changes. Let's start with this little phone. This phone has changed the way you as a passenger travel. It's changed the way you use our airport. Ticket counters are almost obsolete. And you've asked for outlets, outlets everywhere, Wi-Fi quality. That's the number one thing you've requested, and so we've responded. We are currently increasing. We're adding over 10,000 outlets throughout our concourses and terminal, and last year invested $3 million in improving the quality of our Wi-Fi. And today, there is an app for everything. You can book your flight, pick your ticket. You can reserve parking in our parking garage, all on this little device. You know, it's a lot different than when our parents traveled. In those days, airports were just places to catch planes. You didn't expect much, maybe a hot dog, a hot cup of coffee, a newspaper. Today, you want a wide variety of experiences and dining options, shopping options. And airports are stepping up. There are airports that have restaurants with iron chefs, high-end retail, exhibits, music, rides. We're not, aside from this trend, we're doing the same thing. You've seen us reimagine our concessions program over the last few years, giving you more terrific local brands and some signature experiences like the beer garden that we did last fall. And we've got a lot more coming up, including a terrific microbrewery that'll open on the plaza first quarter next year. So stay tuned for all of those. But you know, all of the changes in the last 20 years have not been good. Who could have predicted that this agency called TSA would be stood up and the resulting security queues that you would have to deal with? Do you remember the Great Hall when we opened? It was a traveler's oasis. It had water and trees and nice places to sit. Now it is a stress-filled environment with travelers who are concerned they're going to miss their flight. Our number one passenger complaint are these lines. Passengers approach on the 6th level, they look down, and they think those lines are actually much longer than they are. The truth is, our wait times are at the national average or below most days, but the perception is that they are really, really long. Plus, you don't want to disrobe in that big open space. Well, disrobe may be a little harsh. This summer, we are expecting 10 record days of traffic. For those of you who have vacation plans, listen to me carefully. Our traffic is up 6% year to date over last year. We're growing. All airports in America seem to be growing, and TSA is scrambling to accommodate the summer crowds that are facing them. I will say that, you know, you've got to give TSA credit. Post-Belgium, they are spending more time with you and with your bags, and they should, because we all want a secure travel experience. But the reality is we need to find a way to get you through the lines quicker. So our airline partners and the airport have given the TSA auxiliary personnel this summer. Some of our staff and airline staff will be helping you to divest of your pockets and to run the bins in order to let the TSA workers focus on what it is they are there to do. That said, I would still ask you to plan for 2 hours for a trip this summer, because we just don't know what will happen. It's stressful. And as a result, who could be more popular than our new employees, our canine airport therapy squad, cats, as we like to call them. They are among our most popular staff. Not that we're competitive, but I got to tell you, other airports have therapy dogs too. We're really ticked off. San Francisco now has a pot-bellied pig, right? And they introduced it with hashtag when pigs fly. So, not to be outdone, we are thinking miniature pony. Anybody got one? I'd like to see you after the program. Seriously though, who would not want to hug one of these to de-stress a little after the TSA experience? Our major facility focus right now is to reimagine the Great Hall, which we talked about. We want to return it to that traveler's oasis. We want to create a front door to our plaza and our hotel and the train. There are four parts to our program. First and foremost, we are going to consolidate our ticket lobbies. As I said, ticket lobbies are becoming obsolete. So we're going to condense them. And then in the space that's left over on the sixth floor, we're going to relocate the TSA out of the Great Hall up onto the sixth floor level. And in doing so, we're working hand in hand with the TSA to do a different type of checkpoint, a different type of security screening process, so that it is not the stressful, violating feeling that you get going through security today. We're then going to modify our baggage system to accommodate those moves, but also to make your checked bag screening much more efficient for TSA, so they can use less resources on that and more on passenger screening. And then finally, we are going to take this Great Hall and create a new and imagine, and if you can imagine something very Colorado, selling Colorado sports apparel, Colorado brand restaurants, and some experiences. Many of you have heard me say it. Yes, zip lining is a possibility. Another major initiative we have is to maximize our revenues so that we can reduce the cost to our airline partners. That's why the Den Real Estate Program is so incredibly important to us. And I'm delighted to tell you that we just hired an executive vice president for real estate, someone that many of you might know. Daryl Jones is joining us in just a couple of weeks. He's here in the audience today. And thanks to the support of the voters last November, Daryl is now going to be able to develop 1,500 acres of our property as commercial use and another 15,000 as airport accessory use. So he has a lot of opportunity there. The tax revenues that we generate will be shared between Adams County and Denver, but all of the lease revenue comes back to the airport. That is supplemental income that allows us to maintain competitive costs for our airlines, that allows them to get a higher yield at our airport, and hopefully incents them to add flights and more pair cities. We already know that our land is attractive to companies coming to Colorado. Panasonic, of course, chose our transit-oriented development station at 61st and Pena to locate the headquarters of their enterprise solutions company. They have told us that they looked at over 20 cities and they chose us because A, we have a nonstop to Narita. B, they had the opportunity of being at a rail station. That proximity to commuter rail was important. And also because there was a commitment by the city and by the airport and by the other landowners at this transit station to make it a true, smart, sustainable development. A development with solar power and a microgrid, smart streetlights, information being disseminated to all the users so that they can make more informed usage of electrical appliances. And we're looking at adding housing and retail, a hotel and a wellness center to make it a true community, not just a development. Let's turn back a second, though, to our core mission. I want to talk about growth and about capacity. Our airport was planned to accommodate 100 million passengers at full build-out. That is going from our current 6 runways to 12 runways. But something changed in the last 20 years, and that is the capacity of a runway. You know, since 1995, we've seen planes get bigger. The Airbus A380 aircraft is one example of that. But we've also been working to implement FAA's new technology for tracking and controlling aircraft called NextGen. We've redesigned our airspace, and we've been turning on new arrival and departure procedures over the last couple of years. And as a result, we've reduced fuel usage, we've saved the airlines millions of dollars in fuel and time, we've decreased emissions, and yes, we have increased the capacity of our runways. So today, our projection is those 12 runways could potentially accommodate 150 to 175 million people, not the 100 million that was originally projected. But that's going to be some other administration's headache, not mine. Our growth challenges today are gates, gate availability. We have much stronger requests for gates than we have gates available. By 2020, we will have to add 20 additional gates to the airport. And that's no problem. Our airport was designed to grow, just not this fast. By telescoping out concourses A, B, and C to their maximum length, we will be putting even more pressure on that train that connects the concourses to the terminals. So we'll be adding a train set over the next few years. And speaking of growth, we are working to leverage all of our existing connections as we seek new air service targets. We operate a very strong Star Alliance hub, and we hope to connect to other destinations that are similarly Star Alliance hubs, like Bogota, Zurich, Auckland, Beijing. In this way, we can create one-stop connections that really will connect you to everywhere on the globe. We're also courting connections that have strong community and business markets and interests in Denver, such as Dubai, Monterey, and Paris. Paris is our number one unserved destination, all you airlines who are in the room who have the capability of fly transatlantic. I'm just saying. But the truth is, we are a global city and region now, and we need to have easier global reach. Just to close, so we are preparing for the future of this amazing airport, and it is a challenge as it requires some very fuzzy and imperfect crystal ball gazing. But we are so well positioned both physically, to grow and to assure that this asset continues to outperform all estimates that were ever made of our economic impact and to remain the vital global port for our region. Thank you very much.
Our next presenter is the Wizard of Denver's new Oz, a 400-acre smart city at Pena Station. Let's welcome to the stage Jim Doyle, president of Panasonic Enterprise Solutions.
Good afternoon. It's great to be here. It's great to be here in Denver. I'm celebrating my 11th month here in Colorado, so another beautiful day. Kim, I think, did a great lead-in for Panasonic and what we're trying to do here around smart and sustainable cities, which we've labeled and actually launched in January at the Consumer Electronics Show with Mayor Hancock on stage, what we call City Now. So before I jump into some discussions of what we're doing in Japan and what we're going to do here at Pena Station next, I'd like to start with a short video.
City Now is an ambitious initiative that we started about a year ago in North America. and it's based on the work that we've done over the last 8 to 10 years in Japan and other parts of the world around smart cities.
You know, the city of Denver and Panasonic share a common goal. That goal being to empower people through the real-time delivery of information and services. I saw firsthand the power of Panasonic CityNow efforts in Fujisawa, Japan.
First and foremost, we have a living, breathing, functioning, smart, sustainable town in Fujisawa. It's a separator. It's 400 families living there right now. I believe there'll be 1,000 by 2018. That's significant. So we've actually done it. We've walked the walk, and it's functioning.
Denver has more opportunity for commercial development than any other airport in the United States. With a new commuter rail between the airport and downtown Denver, it's time to capitalize on this tremendous asset. We're currently working with our local partners in Panasonic to kickstart this vision.
But to see what we thought was a good idea become an extraordinary idea with everything that Panasonic can bring to the table. Not only just the smart city at Peña Station, but also their strength in automobiles, electronics, all those things can be part of answering the questions that we want to be, which is a global city.
Some of the most interesting technological advancements in the development include a microgrid, a pilot system for smart LED streetlights, and a solar parking canopy.
The idea is for the microgrid to power the entire 400 acres. That's creating redundant power source throughout that entire perimeter is the idea. And again, the initial step was the implementation of the 1.3 megawatts, where to place that solar array, and the partnership with Xcel and Denver Airport.
In Japan, we're the clear market leader in intelligent transportation management systems. And we're bringing that technology and capabilities to the U.S. to improve vehicle safety and throughput, to enhance the driving experience, and to facilitate the introduction of autonomous vehicles. This hasn't been done anywhere in the United States.
I've never been more excited. I've never had more fun. I've never been more proud of what we're doing. We have a partner now in Panasonic that thinks the way we do, and obviously the city and county does too. The ability at this stage of our corporate evolution to be again leading the charge is pretty exciting. And we're extremely passionate about it and unbelievably dedicated.
It's ultimately about making our residents' lives better, simpler, more comfortable, and more connected.
So beyond the things that businesses normally think about in a day-to-day environment, this is a program that potentially, at its very core, could start to change what North America looks like. And if you change North America, you're going to start to change the world.
We couldn't have found a better partner than Panasonic to come here and be a part of that, the answers for the next generations to come.
Thank you. I think I should have refrained from that changing the world point when my boss sees that, because my revenue targets are probably going to go up astronomically based on that. I'm here to talk about the trains piece, but I'm not really going to talk about trains per se. I'm going to talk about the impact of trains and what you can see at Peña Station next and some of the things that we've done. So obviously Panasonic is a large Japanese conglomerate. It's funny, I go back to Japan and I get so excited to talk about transit-oriented development. And I joke that I sit there in the picture in the upper left in Osaka Station, where our headquarters is located close by, and I try to explain to my colleagues how exciting transit-oriented development is. And they look at me as thousands of people are going by to work and saying, Jim-san, what's so new about that? Why do I say that? Because Japan is one extremely large transit-oriented development. If you look at some of the numbers in terms of the sheer facts around Japan, there are 27,000 kilometers of rail crisscrossing Japan. In comparison, in the United States, I think there's 223,000 kilometers. They push 7.3 billion people a year through those trains. In the United States, with 223,000 kilometers, 31 million. 46 of the busiest of 50 train stations in the world are in Japan. So as a country, there's a lot of knowledge there when you start talking about transit-oriented development. Now, it'd be better if one of my colleagues were here from Japan. They would be much more knowledgeable, both personally and from a business perspective, but you got stuck with me. Fujisawa, the smartest, we like to say the smartest and most sustainable transit-oriented development. It's 47 acres outside of Tokyo that is there based on the fact that the rail and transit opportunities around this give you amazing access to Yokohama, to Tokyo, to Haneda, to Narita, and then beyond. There would be no transit-oriented development like Fujisawa SST, which is a smart and sustainable town, if there wasn't that amazing access to rail and, quite frankly, all the multimodal opportunities that exist. Inside of this development, as you saw in some of the video and some of the folks from the city and county and airport have visited, we are actually up to about 1,000 families. It is a living, breathing development. It's not a lab. People get upset because we keep bringing people there to showcase it, and they're like, whoa, this is our house, this is our community. But it's got solar, it's got battery storage, it's got all the elements that make it sustainable. But from a transit mobility perspective, it's very multimodal. Trains are great, but especially in the United States, you have to talk multimodal. So whether it's electric vehicles or it's ride sharing or other opportunities, the one thing you won't see in this picture is a lot of parking spaces. There are no parking spaces. So, in fact, if you go to Japan, it's very seldom that you see a lot of parking spaces because it's the nature of the country. So we want to learn and leverage what we've done in Fujisawa, Japan. So what's next? Well, what's next is Penya Station next. The brainchild of the mayor and Kim Day at the airport and L.C. Fullenweider around this amazing development out near the airport. Our excitement was the idea of the next tacked on to the end of Penya Station. The idea of next is always what's coming, what's the future, what's that thing, that technology, that environment that we are going to build and create that makes living, working, and playing in Penya Station next the best that it can be. Our intent and our focus is not to make this the best in Denver, or the best in Colorado, or the best in North America, but we want to set a very high benchmark with constant innovation into this development that sets the stage that when we have our grand opening of this amazing development, that folks from around the world are going to come see the things that we're going to bring to this amazing place. So Penya Station is the centerpiece of this development, Penya Station Next. Obviously, as you can see in the lower right-hand corner, that is the current station today. Without that station, quite simply, there is no Penya Station Next. There is no Panasonic, especially, at Penya Station Next because of our commitment to transit. About 3 years ago, we moved our North American headquarters in New Jersey to another part of New Jersey. And at our old headquarters, less than 3% of all our employees, of about 1,000 employees, took mass transit. Today, this year, we're happy to announce that 72% of all the employees at our headquarters take mass transit. Now, if you're in New York City, it's not so impressive because a lot of people, but when you're not in New York City and you're taking mass transit, that's a big number when people can take cars. So we are committed to it, not just to be a part of it or have a place to put our logo, but we really want to be a centerpiece of this and be an investor in what this development could be and the showcase that it can be. In addition to all the transportation options that we're going to look at, so for example, autonomous driving, which we're going to have an expert come up and talk about, we are in discussions now with some companies about shuttles. That last mile problem that RTD is so focused on that would vault ridership on RTD is that last mile. So if we can start to look at some of these things like autonomous vehicles and shuttles augmented with taxis and all the other elements of multimodal transportation, I think we can really step that up. Kim had mentioned the microgrid in collaboration with Xcel Energy. That, I think, is, from a sustainability perspective, is a game changer. I think that is a game changer. That is going to be a huge development for Colorado and beyond. And then in terms of the general nature of the technology, Kim had mentioned the apps. You know, the ability to use an app in this development to find out what's going on at the park, to be able to look at information on kiosks, to be able to get that information, because the greatest way to improve congestion and transit is not have to go somewhere. So wouldn't it be amazing if we could just use an app, or we could do it in-home healthcare, things like that, that can avoid us getting on the roads and congesting I-70 like we all love to do today. So in conclusion, I think I agree with Mr. Burns. We look to the future because that's where we're going to spend the rest of our lives. So I think Penn Station Next could be a shining example of that. But the final statement is it only happens when you have great partners to collaborate. There are a billion great ideas around the country. I'm happy I'm here because this is a place you should be proud of it, that those ideas can be fostered and come to reality. So congratulations to Metro Denver and Colorado for having such a great environment for a business like us to be in. Thank you.
Now, let's welcome our final presenter, Philip Kampschoff, partner with McKinsey & Company. He'll give us a look at the future of automobiles and the bleak jobs forecast for crash test dummies.
Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity today to speak about the future of the auto industry. I would like to start my short speech with a small video. Thanks a lot. I'm going to try to do the impossible here to try to explain to you the future of the automotive industry in the next 10 minutes, but I'm going to do my best. As we've heard before, there are several trends that are impacting the auto industry right now. And some would say that the industry is poised to change more over the next 5 years than it has over the last 50 years altogether. Some say 10 years, but nevertheless, the change is going to be very, very significant. When we talk about changes in the industry, it's because several disruptions right now come all together. We have electrification kicking in, basically the move from internal combustion engines to hybrid vehicles to battery vehicles. We also have the topic around connectivity. And we all experience that today already. When you buy a new car, you always get offered to have Wi-Fi in the car already. Or your insurance companies will offer you a dongle that you can put in the car so they can monitor your driving behavior and adjust your policy accordingly. diverse mobility. You all know Uber and Lyft. I'm sure most of you have already taken Ubers. They have grown quite substantially over the last years, and everybody obviously thinks that's going to continue in the next years as well. And last but not least, I want to talk about autonomous driving, because actually that is going to be the true game changer in the auto industry. Now, when we talk about autonomous driving in the auto industry, we always refer to different levels. Yeah? Right now, probably the most advanced are cars that you have driving around. Let's take a Tesla, for example, that you can put on a autopilot on a highway, and that allows you to take off the hands of the wheel. We would classify that probably as autonomous driving level 3. Now, the true game changer is going to be when we move to autonomous driving level 4. That is when you don't need a person in the car anymore. And just to give you an example of that, we did a little bit of a math. A lot of the younger folks ask themselves the questions, especially when they live in an urban area, do I still need to have a car? Is it actually cheaper for me to own a car or just Uber 100% of my time? So we did the math. And this example is roughly for a city like Washington, D.C. And it becomes even more extreme when you talk about Chicago or New York. At 6,000 kilometers, you have roughly the break-even point, so roughly 4,000 miles. If you drive in a year more than 6,000 kilometers, it makes more sense for you to actually own a car. If you drive less, it's cheaper just to Uber 100% of your time and rent a car once in a while. Now, the most important or the most expensive part of your Uber ride is the labor cost of the driver. Now, imagine a world where you have autonomous cars, but you don't have to pay for the driver anymore. The equation changes completely. All of a sudden, the break-even point is 20,000 kilometers. Now, you can ask the question, in an urban area, how many people do actually drive more than 20,000 kilometers in a given year? The answer is just 10%. Or if you flip it around, for 90% of the population in urban areas, it's going to be cheaper to just Uber around than to actually owning a car. Now, there are various advantages that we see in autonomous driving, and I'm going to talk to them a little bit more in specific. But personal safety is going to be one of them. We all assume autonomous cars, once the technology is there, are going to be safer than us actually driving the cars. The available time, right now, you're kind of attached to the steering wheel. You cannot do much other than driving while you spend your time in the car. That is also going to change. And then you have mobility of people that are non-drivers right now. Elderly people, for example, that can't drive themselves. And especially when they not live in an urban area, but in a rural area where no taxis or no Uber is available, these people will be mobile again. And then transportation costs. As you assume that that accidents rates go down, most likely also your insurance policy costs are going to go down with it. And last but not least, you have advantages for the infrastructure, for the society. Imagine an autonomous car will be programmed to actually, you know, drive within the speed limit. So you won't need policemen actually on the highways checking for speed. Yeah. At the same time, you know, I'm looking at some of you who actually like speeding. You can imagine a world where we have something like an HOV lane going from the Denver airport to downtown that is solely for autonomous cars. And because these cars don't crash, we let them go with 140 miles an hour. So things are going to change if you think kind of in these dimensions. Now, a little bit more specific on the advantages. More than 90% of the accidents are caused by human error. The main reasons for it being alcohol and drugs, being speeding, and a distracted driver. And distracted driver actually is picking up in recent years quite significantly as people are texting and emailing. All of that would go away if the autonomous car takes over for you. Think about the implications of it for society. Today, we in the United States spend about 1 million nights in hospitals because of car accidents. We have to go to the emergency room 2.5 million times in a given year. And all the costs of the crashes and to the infrastructure is more than $200 billion every year. Now, this is not a perspective on the US alone, but on a global perspective. We have roughly 1.2 billion drivers every day. On average, they spend 50 minutes in a car driving. So if you do the math, it's roughly a billion hours that we could use more productively if an autonomous car would drive for us. Yeah, that's about twice the big pyramid in Egypt every day, the labor time that it would take to build them every day. And then parking. We heard parking. Kim was talking about parking also at the airport. If you move to autonomous car, think about it more like valet driving, where the autonomous car will take you to your destination. You leave the car, the car parks itself, and it comes back when you're ready to leave. Now, because you don't have to get out of the car anymore in the parking space, you can actually put the cars a lot tighter together. And here I have an example. Roughly, you know, in a space where today four cars fit, you can easily fit five in the future. Most likely also the utilization of cars goes up. So in theory also the number of cars might go down. So overall, we believe you can save about 25% of the parking spaces that we currently have in the United States. And then I want to quickly talk about secondary order implications, because it's not only the automotive industry, it's also related industries. Think about gas stations, for example. If autonomous cars are electric cars and they can go and charge themselves, do you actually still need gas stations in the future? Yeah. Or insurance companies, their business model. Today, you have thousands of agents trying to sell to millions of end customers insurance policies. Now, nobody can expect you to be at fault if your autonomous car crashes. So most likely, it's not going to be you who is insuring the car. It's going to be the car maker. Now, all of a sudden, the business model for an insurance company has to change from a business-to-customer model to a business-to-business model, where instead of millions of customers, you have 50 big OEMs globally. Now, the big question that you probably have is, when is all of that actually going to become reality? And we did some modeling, and we looked at the technologies available. So this is a little bit more of an aggressive scenario, but we believe in 2030, 15% of the new cars sold can be autonomous cars. For that to happen, we believe we have to overcome three main challenges. One, in terms of technology, but then again, if you look at it, in reality, we are already there. We can already produce autonomous car. There's not much left for us to uncover to have the technology ready. There's a question still around map data. We need high definition maps. That is just a question of time until we gather all the data for that. Another question is going to be regulatory approvals. What we see right now is that every state treats autonomous driving a little bit differently. And the big challenge is, how can we come to a federal standard? What is going to be the testing standard of an autonomous car that the autonomous car has to pass before it can actually be on the road? And last but not least, it's the customer. The customer needs to be willing to pay a little bit more money, because you need all the sensors, the radar, the lidar, the cameras. But also, we need to have confidence in the safety of an autonomous car. And we all don't like to give up control and pass it on to the machine and just trust it, especially when it comes to our family members. So there's always a big question around, when are we as a society ready to give up control? And especially if you think about it, there are going to be autonomous cars crashing, especially in the beginning. So what does that do to the society? Are we still capable of building up sufficient trust to give up control and pass it on to autonomous cars? With that, I want to finalize. I hope I didn't go too much over. Thanks a lot for your attention.
Right, we've got a little time for some Q&A with our panel, and I think it was a terrific insight in terms of what's coming both to Denver in the very near future, but also to all of the cities around the United States and the world. Kim, we'll start with you. You know, you touched a little bit on the expansion that's coming, the growth that's unprecedented. So how is technology and how do you plan for technology to make that movement of people efficient and an enjoyable experience? How does DIA look at that?
So I think we see technology as an amazing opportunity for our passengers to have a better experience, a more efficient experience. Today you use your phone to do so many things. I joke, soon you're going to be able to lose your own luggage. But the reality is, the airlines will lose less luggage because of technology. So it's going to make a more efficient and a much better process in general. I think there are also ways that you don't know that we are using technology today. For example, when you're waiting in that TSA queue, if you have Bluetooth turned on in your phone, we are tracking your time so that we can assess that against what the TSA says your wait time is. We're using beacons out there to do that. We are also seeing a great opportunity for us to push personalized information to you on your phone in the coming years. I'm hoping that you will get off of a flight and you will get a message that says, Jim, your connecting flight is two gates up at B23. On your left is a little coffee place. If you'd like, we'll put in your latte order now. And by the way, your flight's 5 minutes late, so you have, you don't have to worry about that. That'll happen. I mean, that may sound a little far-fetched, but we're getting there. We have on Concourse C today, we have iPads that allow you to communicate as you sit there and order. One day soon, you're going to be able to scan your phone over those, and the iPad will read your boarding pass and be able to, give you information about your flight. It'll also know what you ordered last time you were in our airport and suggest perhaps you want to try something else this time. So I think as we talk about the passenger experience, your expectations getting higher and trying to make the experience better for you, we see technology doing that. And then I haven't even talked about, the technology that's going on in aircraft. We talked about the sky and next gen, but aircraft are getting quieter. The humidity is better in the planes, as we're talking about the 787. So every aspect of your travel experience, I think, is getting better because of technology.
Fantastic. Thanks, Kim. Jim, it's great to see the investment of Panasonic here in Colorado and what you've been able to achieve in a short amount of time. Panasonic's been in a lot of smart city initiatives, it looks like. Was there something different about the experience, the planning, and the collaboration here that's allowing you to move faster?
Absolutely. I think that's one of the things I was saying in my closing remarks. There are, if you look around the world, whether it be in Seoul or Masdar in the Middle East or what we did in Fujisawa took 8 years of meticulous planning to develop this 47 acres. We were so excited here because we have the ideas. I think we were talking about the autonomous cars and the fact that a lot of the technology exists. Technology can always be optimized, but it's here. So the things to make a smart and sustainable city are more about the will and desire of the public and private partnership that comes together to make it happen than, quite frankly, it is about the technology. There's always the financial elements and the numbers, but right now those work in terms of the penetration of renewable energy and the adoption of autonomous driving and things like that. But at the end of the day, if you have an unwilling partner or a partner that's willing, but it is so laborious for a commercial partner or a public partner to get to the finish line, it doesn't work. So one of the things that we saw and we were excited about coming here to Colorado was that collaborative nature, the willingness to not so much take huge risks, but just lean forward, right? If as I say to my folks, if you're going to fall, at least fall forward. And I like that. I think there's that spirit here in Colorado to take some chances push the envelope a little bit and quite frankly, get some stuff done.
Very good. Philip, it's clear that technology is already largely available to recognize the vision you've got. It still seems like a little bit further out, 2030, 2040. But in terms of city planning, that's actually not that very far. Mm-hmm. So what are you seeing as the steps that both state, city, and federal government should be taking to help onboard this kind of technology?
Yeah. I think it's a good question. It's probably two or three things that I can think of. I think one is around infrastructure. If you see the move, and before we move to actually autonomous cars, we will see more the boom of the electric cars, actually. So there's the big question around, does the city of Denver provide the sufficient electric infrastructure, the sufficient charging stations to actually make that feasible? And if you look at some of the cities around the world, you see, you know, China being very aggressive on it and other countries. So I think there's also some to be learned from other countries in that regard. Also, if you look at cities like Munich, they have dedicated parking spaces for car sharing, where you can just with your mobile phone unlock a car like Zipcar. And take it for the day, and they have dedicated parking spaces for that. If you think a little bit further down the line, what I mentioned around the HOV lanes, you can also think about, do we have dedicated HOV lanes for electric cars first, then eventually we're gonna move on to autonomous cars. I think that's kind of the infrastructure. On the regulatory piece, I think I would really push for make it an environment that is open to autonomous driving and to open to testing autonomous cars, and then making sure that we find a federal standard as soon as possible, where right now we see every state kind of going a little bit on their own way, but taking that to the next level and making that really feasible. And then last but not least, I think it's a whole new business that is being generated with a move that we see in the auto industry right now. We have so many startups, so many companies that are flourishing. They weren't there 5 years ago. Think about, as Denver, how can we participate in that growth? How can we generate an environment that is very attractive for entrepreneurs to come here to be a founder of a new company and really participate in the disruption we see in the industry?
You know, let's build on that to close. You know, Jim and I represent technology companies, and we've decided to make a big investment here. But with the infrastructure that's being put in place and the growth and the recipe book that's here in Denver, what are some of the steps that we should be taking potentially, both with state and city government, to attract even more new companies to start up and incubate? And do you see any recipes that have come out of other cities, Philip or Jim or Kim, that says, hey, this is how we can really start to get a wave of innovation going? Any ideas to close on that?
So I've seen, I've seen it to some extent in Europe. There was always the battle between Berlin and Munich and Germany. Berlin always used to be the startup hub, and Munich always tried to catch up. I think the big game changer was when companies like your companies actually join forces and say, hey, we want to create an environment that is attractive for entrepreneurs. And they would actually rent out spaces in their office spaces as incubators and say, hey, you don't have to pay us. You just come with your startup and we provide you the infrastructure. Or they would organize conferences where everybody would come together so the more grown-ups can teach a little bit and the younger can learn from the older ones.
Perhaps something for us to collaborate on, Jim.
Yes, I agree.
Great. Well, with that, I really want to thank our panel. Fantastic insight. Great work.
Great.
Tommy.
Thank you.
Please welcome Denver's most interesting man, the godfather of regionalism, captain of the Starship Enterprise, your closer, Tom Clark, CEO of the Metro Denver Economic Development Corporation.
Jesus, when is this going to stop? Every January, Janet Fricks, our senior director of marketing, walks in and said, I have an idea. And I know that idea is just to scare the living out of me, okay? And every one of those things are skits she put on my agenda for annual meetings. So I'm not interesting. I'm not the godfather. I could be Ron Burgundy, though, okay? Well, anyway, first of all, thank you all for coming. I've always had this when I started talking to these companies. And by the way, let's thank all of them again for the time and effort they put in for us. In 2003, when we started getting very serious about doing transit and understanding that it would be, if we could build a system-wide transit system, we could revolutionize this metropolitan area. And when people started talking about driverless cars and stuff, and then Uber and Lyft showed up 5 years ago, and I began to get this dream of going into retirement, having the line go to 128th, because I live in Adams County, and getting up one morning and realize that Kelly needs me to tell her what it was like in the old days. And I'm shaving, and my wife comes in and said, I'm taking the car. I've got a meeting right now. And that car is what we call the just-in-case car, should be in my garage. But my just-in-case car has been sold because we have transit. And I'm sitting there and I go, well, I pull out my phone, fire up my app, and the phone says, I need a car. And I need it in 13 minutes. And the car pulls up into my cul-de-sac, and the door opens, and there's nobody driving. And the car says to me, hi, Tom. We're going to the 128th Street station. I know you'll enjoy it. It's $8. But there's somebody on our way that we could pick up, and your price would be $4. What's your preference? And I get in that car, and I drive over, get on the 128th station, and come down to downtown. I thought it was a dream for a long time. Now I realize it's going to be a reality in my life. So when I think of Aero, I love that slogan. I love their mission, 5 years out. And I think of what the future used to be like for us. And for those of you who were around in the 1980s, you remember the future. We were always optimistic about the past because the future looked pretty damn scary. And the future was only a year or two out in front of us because we had so many things we had to catch up on. Our political system was pretty much antiquated, big city kind of politics, city-suburb fights, all that stuff that goes on and was going on all through the country. And we had an economy we had to totally restructure, and that had to happen right now. And those of us who were here in the 80s remember how urgent that was because we had people leaving town. It wasn't like people were flocking to Denver. But for us, there was no really future other than just what was at the end of our nose. But we know now that when you create a culture of innovation, creativity, and collaboration, the pivotal elements, those are the pivotal elements of a metropolitan entity who's looking to play a significant role in their own future, but also the future of their state, their country, and even the world. And we have seen our speed into this realm accelerate dramatically in the last decade. Where we once sought to assert our role as a national leader, there's now confidence that such a role is one we can play and successfully perform. That sense of self-confidence is extraordinary and powerful. This event is the beginning of what we hope is going to be a series of looks at innovation globally and where our role is in it and how we can take advantage of that. And, you know, we have 9 innovation clusters in our economy. And the joke has always been in our office, in 1985, the economy was Coors, carbon, and the Cold War. That was essentially the economy, and only one of those industries was flourishing at the time, which, by the way, brewing flourishes all the time, okay? But the idea of getting to an economy that is so diverse, and all those diversifications are all innovation spaces, we're going to have a lot of topics in the next years as we look at where we are going, and we're going to have a lot of product to talk about. But this collaborative region we live in, which only recently apparently has been discovered by the national press, I've never seen so much stuff about us in the last year and a half. And this, after kind of years of kind of being a little bit ignored, it can be pretty heady thinking to ourselves about, boy, this is really cool stuff, and we're really cool. And we are cool, but we don't want to talk about that too much. But it was a hard-won contest to get here, and congratulations to all of us. But I always remembered by a comment of sitting in a room like this, and Gordon Black, who was the pollster for Gallup, or USA Today, said, remember that trends create the circumstances of their opposition. And that as you push forward, people push back. Which, of course, reminded me immediately of another quote, which says, every person has each year our moment of madness, when we tie a rope around our neck, hand the end of it to our worst enemy, and say, pull. And if you read some of the amendments on the ballot this fall, you'll see that we may be doing that for some people. As an antidote to this kind of self-inflicted wound, we have learned that a good idea comes from anywhere. And the ability to generate those ideas, vet them, and move them forward, and give credit to its creators increases the level and speed of transactions, and the accelerated transactions make stronger and more innovative economy and reinforce the importance of collaboration. So today we've seen a portion of the future of transportation and the mobility choices coming at us much faster than many of us thought. I'm excited that we're going to be a part of this revolution and not a spectator. So thank you all again. Hope to see you next year. Have a great day. And my watch says we finished on time. Thanks.